Our hymn is number 299, Holy, 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 299.
For decades and generations, they're really very much in the news internationally of late because of, first of all, on October 31st, the founder of the Knights of Columbus was beatified, second stage on the way to sanctity, the same thing. And then, within just this past week, there is a turnover in the international leadership. That doesn't happen, you know, every 4 years or every year, every 2 years, like councils. That happens only after a pretty long stretch, and in this case, 20 years. Only in Carl Anderson, this is a person who represents Knights of Columbus internationally. He has the status of an ambassador. He is our direct contact, for example, with the Pope and other heads of state. So Carl Anderson announced his retirement this year, and there'll be, of course, a transition to his successor. We have Anderson with us today. Troy tells me that he has looked to see if there's any kinship with the Supreme Knight, Carl, but hasn't found it yet. Troy's more of a local fellow. He's from Scottsville. He's the founding the Grand Knight of the Council there. I've invited him to come and tell us a little bit more about the Monsignor McGivney, now Blessed Michael McGivney, and about his work as an insurance agent and about the development and recruitment of Knights of Columbus. So anyway, that's a little setup for our next hour or so to prepare ourselves, as always, to hear the gospel, to reflect on the Lord's presence in our lives, and to experience his presence sacramentally. We say a little short prayer, and I think it's a great help to us because it reminds us that we're not here because we're perfect. We're not here because we think of ourselves as being better than somebody else. We're here because we're redeemed. So we pray, Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Christ have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive me sin and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
And for the third time this morning, let's invoke the praise of the Trinity. Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be,
world without end.
Amen.
And the prayer that's prayed by 1.25 billion Catholics throughout the world today. Keep your family safe, O Lord, with unfailing care, that relying solely on the hope of heavenly grace, we may be defended always by your protection through our Lord Jesus, our Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Now let's be seated for the reading.
He is a slave who longs for the shade, a hireling who waits for his wages. So I have been assigned months of misery, and troubled nights have been allotted to me. If in bed I say, when shall I arise? Then the night drags on. I am filled with restlessness until the dawn. My days are swifter than a weaver's shuttle. They come to an end without hope. Remember that my life is like the wind. I shall not see happiness again. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise the Lord who heals the broken heart.
pursued Jesus, and on finding him, said, "Everybody's looking for him." Jesus said to them, "Let's go on to the nearby villages, that I may preach there also. For this purpose have I come." So he went into their synagogue, preaching and driving out demons throughout the whole of Galilee. The gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, just to tip you off a little bit more about what Troy's going to unpack much more eloquently than I am, I mentioned the international attention that's fun to get the beatification of last October. Again, second step on the way to canonization of the saint. And we have, I think, been aware of the national news of cases before. As you would know, one of the testimonies has to do with miraculous healing in the name of a particular saint. For example, Mother Teresa was beatified. There was a nun in France, a sister who had cancer and miraculously cured. So those things always seem kind of distant to us. Troy's going to tell you about how the case of Blessed Michael Mukundi, the miracle involved somebody in our own region. So I'll leave that to him as he, again, with his background and the nice numbers, tell us more about the organization. Troy?
Like you said, my name is Troy Anderson. I am the field agent for the central part of Kentucky with Lions and Wolves, including councils in Eatown, Vine Grove, and others in the area. How many here currently do we have that are Knights? Good deal. I'd like to start by thanking you all, Father Brown, for giving me a few minutes. Father Brown has actually been a Knight for 46 years. But thank you for allowing me a few minutes about how this wonderful attorney. The Knights were started in 1882 by Blessed Father Michael J. Mukundi. He was a pastor of a very poor Irish parish in New Haven, Connecticut, and he recognized many of the problems that faced young Catholic families. The fraternity is still focused on these today. The three greatest benefits of becoming a Knight is to become a better man, father, and husband. The Knights are here to be an extension of our faith, through the works that we do in the community and the parish, but most importantly, through our family. Many know about the fundraising that the Knights of Columbus Spirit do through bingos, fish fries, and pancake breakfasts. But these are just the tip of the iceberg of the work that the Knights do. Locally, the Council of Elizabethtown is getting ready to co-host the 56th Annual Brotherhood Banquet. And last year, they were able to help raise $38,100 for President Charity. And since the inception of the banquet, they've helped raise over $800,000. The Vine Grove Council was able to come together this past Christmas and hand deliver over 130 food baskets to families in need. They were also able to raise over 800 brand new toys for children in the area. We've all had a tough time this past year as we learned to operate in many different ways. How many thought that they would spend Many would spend the holidays over a computer camera. For the Knights, the year had its challenges as well. And I'm here to tell you about some of the wonderful things that happened through the year. Our founder did have a miracle occur through his intercession, which gave way to his beatification on October 31st, 2020. On top of that, the miracle that was approved was the healing in utero of the 13th child of the general agent for Kentucky and Tennessee, Daniel Shepard. This is my boss. It was his son. I never thought I'd be this close to this type of miracle. I found out that he had an incurable disease in utero called high drops. There was a chance that the mother could actually contract the disease as well. And instead of ending the pregnancy like most doctors told him to do, they invoked the intercession of Father McGivney. Knights around the world began to pray for this family. Supreme council, actually pray daily for the intercession of Father forgive me. And only 30 days later, after a mission trip that they had been on, they came back and found that the high drops was gone, with no explanation on it. They said that the high drops was not going well. To confirm even more of the miracle that Father forgive me was involved with this, Mikey's birthday is on the anniversary of the signing of the first charter for the Knights of Columbus. Just for the record, Mikey's now six and doing well. This past year, the Knights of Columbus also topped the 2 million member mark for the first time in our history, so we are still growing. The insurance program has once again had the most productive year ever in protecting our Catholic families and assisting in our financial well-being. What I'm here to talk to you about today is not insurance. Are you all happy about that? Almost your insurance already. What I'm here is to ask the men of the parish to consider in helping the Knights of Columbus by becoming a member. Right now, you have the opportunity to join online as a member for absolutely free. During this time, you can participate when possible and decide which council is best for you. If you decide to get into a council, you will then go through the degrees and can become a full council member. I will be here after Mass to answer any questions that you have about signing up or anything else about the Knights of Columbus. I've made it simple. There's a simple paper for you to fill out with some basic information, and I can help take care of the rest of it to get you going from there. Thank you for your time, and be God in service. Bless you, Father Michael. Take care.
Thanks, Troy. There is an aspect of our history, two things that I want to mention. One that Troy spoke of briefly about the fact that Michael McGilley was a young priest, and in his parish, he had a lot of first response, police and firefighters and so on. And of course, in the late 1800s, we didn't have kind of financial assistance as we have today in terms of things like Social Security, not coming until 1933, and other responses. And what McGivney did was he said, let's organize men in the parish for spiritual purposes and fraternity, and then have them raise money to self-insure our families so that when provider was lost in the line of duty, then there would be insurance that would help them. And so that was really the beginning. It was now to an international product, the insurance company and the charity. But then as things went on through the decades, and other fraternal and social orders started, there wasn't always harmony between, let's say the Shriners, and the Knights of Columbus. And there were some pretty ugly clashes over the years. Well, 1965, a Knight and a Shriner in Hardin County said, not in our community and not on our watch. You've heard me tell that story before, and I tell about this time every year when Bill Harris and Tom Clark decided that they would put together this brotherhood banquet, so the 56th annual. My only beef with Supreme, by the way, is that we have, since the 50th anniversary, sent an article to them for the International Magazine, and they don't respond to it. So I may demonstrate up in New Haven someday.
Okay.
Not really, but anyway, Tom usually brings us the raffle tickets. Phil, I'm sure, has some too. I've got some. And the fourth or fifth year in a row, the capital prize is a freezer full of beef. You get a freezer and the beef. That event is online this year. We won't be gathering at the Pritchard Community Center as we have in the past, but other elements of the fundraising project will go on. So this Sunday is the 7th, 14th and the 21st, we'll have those raffle tickets here. So you can see any one of us to participate in that. But let's go back to that bizarre moment where Jesus is doing miracles, but he doesn't want the word spread. And you notice this is early on in Mark's gospel. This is the beginning of Mark's gospel, not the very beginning, but early on. It's been something early in Jesus' career. And from the scholars that I've read, my own reflection, I think it's a question of Jesus knowing that he's the Son of God and the Son of Man, but not broadcasting that just yet, because his own growth in the Spirit has got to take place. He's got to develop that courage. He's got to develop that boldness. He's got to develop that preparation for rejection that could very possibly come. And of course, he takes a couple of years to do that. We know that the public ministry is basically about 3 years. So what I want to do, just to wrap up our liturgy of the word, is go to a hymn that you know well. Don't tell me the number for it, and I will raise you up. If I am the bread of life, it probably is in the alphabetical.
390.
390. Okay. Yeah, there it is. You know it well. But what I want to do is, as I said, wrap up our liturgy of the word by jumping ahead in Jesus' life. So it's the early part of his ministry in the Gospel of Mark that we heard today. But this, then, is in John's Gospel, 6th chapter, when he very boldly says, I am the bread of life. Consume me, in a sense, as you would food. I will raise you up on the last day, and I'll do everything in between, too, in terms of giving your life meaning. And of course, again, if you look at the fine print, it's John chapter 6. But that's that one moment when Jesus gives a speech that people walk out on. In large numbers, they walk out on him. They're rejecting him. And this is, in effect, the beginning and the end. He gets public about his ministry. He gets confident and proclaims who he is. And, of course, it takes him all the way to Calvary. I am the bread of life. You who come to me shall not hunger. You who believe in me shall not thirst. No one can come to me unless the Father beckons. And I will raise you up, and I will raise you up, and I will raise you up on the last day. Jesus' own words again, the words of Jesus at the Last Supper. Let's all be seated now. Ever God Almighty, blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to offer, which earth has given in human hands and made, will become for us the bread of life.
Blessed be God forever.
Eruka Adonai, blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to offer. Fruit of the vine, work of human hands, it will become our spiritual bread.
Blessed be God forever.
Lord God, we ask you to receive us and be pleased with the offering which we present to you. Humble and contrite hearts. Now pray, everybody, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Amen. O Lord our God, who once established these created things to sustain us in our frailty, grant, we pray, that they may become for us now the sacrament of eternal life. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation. Always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty and Eternal God, for in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. And having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in this paschal mystery. Now with the angels and saints, in joyful celebration, we acclaim. Supper was ended, Jesus took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take this all of you and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me. the mystery of faith. Blessed Michael, forgive me. St. Ignatius, loyal, all saints, who please you throughout the ages, with them may we merit to be co-heirs to eternal life. May we praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus. For it is through Jesus, and with Jesus, and in Jesus, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, that all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Here is the Lamb of God, Jesus, who takes away the sin of the world. Happy are we who are called to suffer the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof,
but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
In the body and blood of Christ, keep us safe to eternal life.
Our communion hymn is number 469, How Great Thou Art, 469.
Yeah.
Well, I've got another little nice Columbus story. He's always got some kind of story, doesn't he? Sure enough, I was in my office as the battalion chaplain at Camp Lejeune, North Carolina, one day, and the phone rang. And the voice on the other end said, "Chaplain?" I said, "Yes, this is Chaplain Brown." And the fellow said, "Well, I represent a Catholic fraternal organization called the Knights of Columbus." And I said, "Oh, really?" He said, "Yes, and you have a young Marine in your battalion who is a member of our fourth degree assembly here in Maryland. And we are considering him as a finalist for our fourth degree Knight of the Year, and we want to get your evaluation of it. So we need a bit of a character reference, Chaplain. Do you know this young Marine?" I said, "Yes, I do." So I proceeded to say a few things about this young man named June Ramos. Don't be known. And he'll have his own chapter probably in my book, because I've got all kinds of stories about Ramos. He went to boot camp. I'm going to digress just a little bit, but just give you a little bit of background. He went to boot camp at the age of 31. He was about this tall and solid as a fire hydrant, and was meritoriously promoted during the time that I knew him. In service, but that started back in group. Anyway, I made some pretty positive comments about this young Marine to the fellow on the other end of the line. And so, anyway, I said, "Well, hope that helps you." And he said, "Yes, that's all I'll need, Chaplain." And I said, "Well, have you got another minute?" And he said, "Well, yes." And I said, "Well, I've been a fourth degree Knight of Columbus since 1976. He said, "Father, I had no idea I would get a Catholic chapel on the phone." And so anyway, he said, "Well, we sure appreciate your input, and we'll let you know how things come out." Well, about a week later, he said, "Well, guess what, Father? Your Marine is our Knight of the Year for Maryland. And not only do we want to fly him up here for the ceremony, but we want to fly you up and have you be the guest speaker." So, got a lot of knowledge out of that phone call. Ramos has now been a priest for, let me see, he was ordained the summer I got home. He got home a couple years before me. He was ordained in the Diocese of Santa Fe on his birthday in 2010. So, gosh, he's coming up on his 11th anniversary. But a lot of great stories. He was wounded, in fact, in Iraq. Took a piece of shrapnel in here, landed behind his nose. They extracted it through the nostrils. I visited him in the hospital in Baghdad, and some of him was back on the front line within 2 weeks. Lots and lots of good stories about Jim Ramos, including the fact that whenever we would get anonymous care packages, most of us would open ours and we would find beef jerky, playing cards, golf balls, you know, something like that. Well, Corporal June Ramos opened his and he found hand lotion and nylons and... But as I mentioned, he was from the Philippines. It's the brother named Jupiter. And another brother named Julius. He had a sister, I think she might have been a mayor. But anyway, Jupiter Julius June. And he was born on the 24th of June, so that's why I'm very named. But there are other great stories, including the fact that he came to see me on his way home from the seminary. And one of the councils in Jefferson County presented him a fourth degree chalice. The chalice that I use every Sunday is a fourth degree. Another Knights of Columbus custom of presenting a chalice to a newly ordained priest. So, Ramos got one from the council in Northern. So, anyway, well, it's 4 minutes till 10, And raise your hand. 10 o'clock, raise your hand. Yeah. And by the way, just in deference to our brothers and sisters in Grayson County, they have a very strong council, of course. We all have benefited from their fish fries and community. So, Troy, thanks again for joining us today. Happy to have you. And old business, new business. And how about a blessing and send us out, Father? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Lift the hand and pray. O God, who will that we be partakers in the one bread and the one chalice, grant us, we pray, so to live that made one in Christ we may joyfully bear fruit for the salvation of the world. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon us all and remain with us this day, this new week, and for us.
Amen.
Just one more thing, apropos of my last story about working at Camp Lejeune. I've pretty well put together now a little museum of memorabilia from my time of service. So sometime when we can gather together again, I'll start hosting little tours of the lower level of the hall. I think there will be some things you'll find interesting, and I'll find it fun to talk about. We go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Take us out, Phil.
Number 565, For the Healing of the Nations, 565.